power of the Holy Spirit makes us the body of Christ. Today we'll hear a couple of stories about God's grace unfolding. Stories that take a bit of a turn. Turns out we like them. So we come to give God our lives, that God might work one of those miraculous turns for each of us. With open hearts, we worship together.
God of love, you create us and claim us. You love us and guide us.
We praise you and worship you.
Beloved Christ, you heal us and forgive us. You teach us and lead us.
We thank you and we follow you.
Holy Spirit, you unite us and transform us. You empower us and shine in us.
We open our hearts to you and live by your grace. Hallelujah.
Let's pray.
Spirit of love, you come to us in many ways. Open our hearts to see you before us. Open our ears to hear your voice. Open our hearts to receive your love and to bear your love to all. In the name and the grace of Christ. Amen.
The Old Testament reading comes at the end of Joseph's story. Joseph's brother sold him into slavery in Egypt, but he became an important administrator there, in charge of food supplies. Suffering from a famine, his brothers came to Egypt for food, not recognizing him. Now Joseph has revealed himself to them. A reading from Genesis. Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him, and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as God is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. Please stand in body or in spirit for the Psalter.
Listen for the living word of God as you hear the good news from Matthew's Gospel in the 15th chapter. Jesus left the country. He went to the country of Tyre and Sidon. And when he was there, a Canaanite woman from that country came and began shouting, "Have mercy on me, Master, Son of David. My daughter is being tormented by a terrible demon." And Jesus did not answer her at all. The disciples came to him and said, "Jesus, tell this woman to go away. She keeps yelling at us." And Jesus said, "I was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But the woman came and knelt before him and said, 'Master, help me.'" Jesus said, "It isn't fair to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." But she said, "Yes, Master, and even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. And Jesus said, Woman, great is your faith. Let it be for you as you have asked. And immediately, her daughter was healed. The Gospel of the Beloved Jesus Christ. That's a tough story to take. We want Jesus to be nice. If not perfect, at least good. And in this story, he ignores the woman who has clearly asked for help. And then he justifies ignoring her. And then he calls her a terrible name. What? Well, let's look at that story, first of all, from Jesus' perspective, which is the way he would have looked at it. Jesus grew up in a racist culture. It's a theocracy in which everybody who mattered was Jewish. All their customs, all their laws were Jewish. And everybody else didn't matter. Jesus grew up in a world in which you would never have seen a sign that said, Gentile lives matter. Because they didn't. And like every culture, what Jesus' culture did is developed a language that dehumanizes everybody who's not like us. Just like we do. Right? We have derogatory names for every race and every nationality other than white people and American people. We can insult anybody by what continent they're from, by what religion they practice, what their skin color is, because they're not us. So when Jesus calls this woman a dog, he's not just insulting her because she's annoying. It's a racial slur. It's the D word. And in particular, pardon the harsh language, but it's not mine. It's Jesus's. He calls her a bitch. She's a female dog. But as cruel as that sounds, he's just reflecting the culture he grew up in. We do the same thing. We do it all the time. We define people according to a language that assumes that we're normal and everybody else isn't. When's the last time you heard somebody refer to a white novelist? No, you're just a novelist, unless you're a black novelist. When's the last time you heard somebody refer to that white senator? We don't call senators white, they're just senators. Well, unless they're Muslim senators or Native American senators or black senators or something other than, you know, normal. We do the same thing. We have this language. So Jesus isn't really being mean to her. He's just reflecting on his culture. But here's the cool thing. There are three miracles in this story. The first miracle is that the woman keeps at it. You know what it's like to have to just go along to get along, right? I bet half the people in this room, who happen to be women, learned early on to pretend that you're not as smart as the boys in school, right? You learn to just be quiet, know your place, don't cause trouble. She doesn't do that. She has every reason to just go away, sit down, and shut up, exactly like the disciples tell her to, or want to tell her to, but she doesn't. Nevertheless, she persisted. She hangs in there, and she comes right there, face to face with him, and she says, Master, have mercy, help me. There's a second miracle. Jesus is not just reflecting his culture. He's reflecting on his culture. When this woman comes in and says, help me out here, Jesus is in a bind because he has come to help people. That's what he does. He helps people. But here's this woman who's not supposed to be helped. right? He's an Israeli and she's a Palestinian, and his job is for Israelis. And he's wrestling with that. He says, but I was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. The second miracle in this story is that he thinks about what he's doing. He examines his own assumptions. And he's really in it. He's so deep in it that when she calls to him, he can't even answer. He's just silent. And the disciples come to him, and all he can do is put out on the table what he's wrestling with. I was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And this woman does this brilliant thing. She tells the parable teller a parable. When he says to her, well, it's not right. I'm trying to figure this out. It's not right to take the children's bread, children being the children of God, being the Israelis, and throw it to the dogs, meaning the Gentiles, the Palestinians, the blacks, those people. And he's wrestling with that. So she tells him a parable. She says, yes, master. Of course, I agree. Oh yeah, I'm not going to fight that. And even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. She's called him master three times. And now in this parable, she tells a story about a master. She is not talking about a parable. She's talking about Jesus. She's got him eye to eye, face to face. She holds his face right in it. And the next miracle is that his eyes are opened. In that moment, Jesus has the opportunity to see the world from the perspective of somebody who lives under the table. For a moment, he imagines, he sees this woman. He sees her as a mother who loves her child. Well, he has a mother who loves her child. And he connects. And for a moment, he imagines what it's like to be a dog, to be somebody who's oppressed, who's rejected, who's dehumanized. What it's like to go around knowing that you've been put in your place. What it's like knowing that you have to manage and manipulate and maneuver and protect yourself all the time in a way that he hasn't had to. It's a white guy really understanding what it's like, what it feels like to get pulled over by a cop and know that your life is in danger. I don't have to deal with that. I just get out my license and show the cop. If I'm black, I have to follow a very specific set of instructions, right? Get my license out before he gets to the car, put my hands on the wheel, speak slowly, don't move, because otherwise I could get shot. And every other month it happens, so I know that. For a moment, Jesus sees what it's like to be a dog because she's connected with him. And the third miracle? No, this is only still the second miracle, isn't it? Is that then she's no longer a dog. She's a person. And he says, woman, great is your faith. Jesus doesn't know anything about her religion, doesn't know what she believes, but he sees her faith, which is her reaching out. That's how Jesus sees faith. Your faith isn't what you think. Your faith is that you reach out, even if you don't believe. You just reach. That's faith. And Jesus sees that, and his eyes are opened, and he sees her in a new way. And after that, he sees all those Gentiles in a new way. He starts saying positive things about other people's faith. He heals the centurion's daughter. He goes off to Gentile territory again. She changes his ministry. That's the second miracle. Of course, there's another miracle. Maybe that's what Jesus is inviting us to do. We don't like that story because we want Jesus to be perfect, but the problem is that we're thinking that what it means to be perfect is to be perfectly right from the beginning. And what Jesus shows us is that what you need to do is to be perfectly open. Sure, he's got these cultural assumptions that he grew up with, but he's willing to question them. And he's willing to listen to what it's like for somebody who lives outside that culture. This last week I've been on vacation, and it was nice to be away from computers and TVs and news and not hear about things. And when I came back, it was interesting what I then suddenly heard about and what I didn't hear about, what it took a while to find out about. While our attention was all focused on the people who matter, which is American politicians, I heard that there was a mudslide in Sierra Leone and 450 people died. And it went right by in our news feed, and we hardly heard more than a sentence about it. See how that works? Their lives don't matter. They're not white Americans. Meanwhile, I heard all these stories. This cross is a cross section of a vine that grows in Venezuela. That's made by these people, a friend of mine in Montana, who's a biology professor, connected with in this little rural village in Venezuela, whose lifestyle is being threatened because the rainforest is being threatened by oil companies who cut down their trees. Turns out that there are these vines that grow in the forest, and you can cut off a section of the vine and drink out of it because it's full of water. But the interesting thing is that the cross section of that vine is a cross. So while he was showing me that and giving me this and talking about that, I was hearing about what it's like to live in a rainforest that's being bulldozed for the sake of oil that powers the car that I drove and that fuels the jet that I flew to get there. And I began to hear what it's like on the other side of the gas pump. I got some emails. I talked with some people. I heard stories about what it's like for them. Talk with some Native Americans who reflect on our feelings about immigration. And they just sit there and they watch us. We're all upset about it, and they just watch us. Immigrants. I got some emails. One was from George and Beatrice, more than one, our friends in the Korogocho slums. Another little thing that went right by in our news feed is that Kenya had an election that was probably pretty darn corrupt, and there's a whole lot of violence afterwards. So they wrote, "Violence has broken out in Korogocho slums where we stay. Gunshots are all over. Some of the children, women, and youths in our program travel to upcountry, while those without anywhere to go have their hope in God." That's what it's like to live under the table. "A gang attacked our neighborhood earlier today at 2 a.m. They only managed to kill 15 people before they left. We don't know why they ran away and what they are planning to do next." That's what it's like to live under the table. I have a pen pal who is incarcerated in a prison in Ohio. And this last week he wrote, "I didn't have any stamps for a while, and I just spent a little of my state pay on a few stamps, so I couldn't write to you. I only get $13 state pay, and I have to split that up on hygiene stamps and phone times, and hopefully snacks if I have anything left. It's a rough road, my friend, but I'm managing to keep my sanity together. There was a bit of a bad moment a few weeks ago. They resumed executions after 3 years of holding off because of a botched execution. Being that this went off with no problems, they're going to start executing on a regular basis now. They have three lined up for the next following months. These people are very serious about taking our lives. It changes everybody when they take somebody off the block." That's what it's like to live under the table. And I think part of what Jesus is inviting us to do is to open ourselves to those stories. few months ago, as part of our immigration series, Wee Chang, who's a pastor here in the conference, he's now the DS in Boston, he told us stories about what it's like to be an immigrant. And one of the things that he mentioned is, you never ask. You don't know my story. You don't know. You've never asked. Why did you come here? What is it like? Jesus and that Canaanite woman are asking us to listen. This last week, when this demonic hate breaks out in this country, and people say, oh my gosh, I can't believe this is happening in 2017, there's a lot of people who will look at us and say, when did you wake up? This has been happening since 1620. This country was founded on racism. You just now figured that out? It's in the Constitution. It's in the Constifracantution that black people are 3/5 of white people. It's written in. This is when we say, this bigotry is not American. Oh yeah, it is. So what do we do about that? We just feel frozen sometimes. What can I do? Well, one thing we can do is we can be public about that. You can go to a march, you can head out to a demonstration or a protest. There's one this afternoon, I'll tell you about it later, in Lexington at 5:00. But you don't have to wait till there's a demonstration. You don't have to drive to another town. Part of what Jesus and this woman are inviting us to do is to listen. To listen to the stories of what it's like for people who live on the other side. Whatever that side is. Notice in a mixed group of men and women how much the men talk and the women just listen. Wouldn't it be interesting if the men said, so you tell us, what's it like? What are we like? And then just shut up and listen. What it would be like for us who are comfortable middle-class folks to really listen to the stories of people who struggle financially. To really listen to what it's like if you have mental illness, or if you're not sure about your gender, or if you've had a history that might be embarrassing to talk about, or there are things that go on in your life that you don't want other people to know about. Well, we make sure we don't talk about those. What if we listened? Jesus shows us this story. This woman tells this parable that opens Jesus' eyes and teaches us that a miracle we can all perform is to listen. It's when Jesus does that, that one more miracle happens. And that daughter is healed. And I think we're all healed when we listen to those stories. That's God speaking to us. Will you pray with me? God, we want to listen to you in trumpets and angels and beautiful sunsets. And so often you speak to us in people who are hurting or people whom we reject. Speak to us and open our hearts to listen. God, we give you thanks for your patience and for the perseverance of those, your saints, who come to us to open our eyes. All of those whom, by your grace, we reject and nevertheless, they persist. We pray for the faith to receive your blessings, to be mindful of your presence and to listen for your voice, and for the courage to trust your deep desire for us, surrendering everything to your love, to live in harmony with your grace. Amen.
Those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, That's what gives us this deep peace, no matter what happens to us. God is with us. As Jesus shows us, as that Canaanite woman, God's love trumps social systems. And that gives us deep peace with God and with one another. The peace of Christ that we are given to share with all the world, beginning with each other. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Share a sign of Christ's peace with a neighbor. It's sort of scary to imagine what it would be like to have to live under the table, you know, to be one of those people that get rejected all the time. It's scary. And therefore, we never go there. And when we do, we discover that's where God lives. What the cross means is that God is present in all those struggles, in those people that we don't identify with or notice. So it's actually a holy thing for us, and a welcome thing, to hear God speak to us from the other side. And we are blessed because we have people who can speak to us. So I'd like for Nikki to come speak to us and tell us a little something about how we connect with some of those other folks.
Hi, everybody. I'm so happy to be here and to be part of you. 2 months in June, actually in May, a lot of us gathered for 2 different days to much begin my journey. A journey that I never shared with you, but most of you now have heard. What is it behind resentment and repentance? I think a lot of people think about it. Why is Nikki doing this? I'm doing this because it's a reflection of me. Those kids you guys are helping is actually me. That's how I grew up. I didn't grow up in a fancy house. I grew up in a rural setting, no lights. I used to study the flame of fire. And I know how it is, that's why I always try to move back. So when you guys made doors, you didn't know it's a life changer. These girls were in tears when we got home. They couldn't believe it. Actually, just go back a little bit. Me and my husband went, but we went on different days. And when we got there, he called me and said, "Nikki, don't you ever bring me just one space." I'm like, "Why?" I was at the airport for 5 hours. He had 2 suitcases, but he didn't understand the parents. Said, I had to pay them for them to release me. They were going through, "Oh, you have 4 shirts, well, what is the 5th shirt for? You have 2 pairs of shoes, what is it?" They went through everything just to frustrate you until you release the money. But anyways, I was like, "Oh, okay, please don't act like I'm not doing it." I took all my 5 suitcases and then I left. As soon as I got to the airport, I mean, they would, especially when they know that this plane is connecting from the United States or from London, they get all fired up because they don't want, they're going to collect some money. So eventually, as soon as I landed with my 5 suitcases, everybody's looking. One young man with a staff here just approached me. "Do you really want to drop?" I'm like, "What do you mean by that?" "So they have so much money." They don't care, but they're all gifts, they don't care. I'm like, "So what do I need to do? Give it to me." I'm like, "Okay, go ahead." It took me 5 minutes for a $20 pay, which was made up that I did. and I got through. So when my first visit was Govan Saturday, I think some of you I've been helping these kids for quite a long time. I involved the chiefs, I involved the leaders. The main reason why I involved all these people was to make this topic comfortable, because it's a taboo to talk about menstruation in my country. You get into this phase of life with trial and error. Nobody even teaches you. You have to ask friends how to do it. And worse still, there are no resources. From first grade to fifth grade, the girls are shining, they are all on the top of the class, but by the time they hit that phase, they just go down. And nobody asks what's going on. So I think involving them, they were very uncomfortable, the kids were very uncomfortable, because it's a topic that cannot be discussed when men are there. But I explained my reason why. I told them, why do you think your girls don't make it? If you ever ask yourself that, why is my girl, or she was first in the first or second grade, and if you ever thought of doing some statistics of other countries, like where I come from now, where the girls really maintain their education level the same way, they didn't have an answer. So I told them I don't have to answer it myself because I'm the girl, I'm that girl who is sitting on the ground. I'm that girl who was never looked at. I'm that girl nobody asked why I was sad or why I wasn't in school. So this is what happens during that period of time, 5 days, when you don't have anything, you'd rather stay home. Who wants to be embarrassed? So you are losing all that education. You have to lie that you're sick. You don't even participate in sport because you know what it is. So I did explain and I told them, see, that's the first time. And I mean, I'm out of that country because of trouble, because I always try to speak up. But I told them, I'm going to speak up for the girls because the girls go through a lot in this country. Where's only the village? There's a lot of things that are called taboos just for the interest of the male partner. Girls are being used as maids. You have 3 girls and 3 boys, and boys never do the chores that we all do here. From school, you're expected to do dishes, you're expected to walk 2 miles to go get some water, and you have these pieces again, menstruation, and nobody cares. So, I told them that my first visit, we used a disposable sanitary pad, and I really didn't see a reason why you should continue that because one, it's expensive, two, you use it once and that's it. And I explained how my church came together and brought all these ideas together, and that was the best we ever did. They were so happy. It's just unfortunate that one school is like about 210 girls. And the other high schools were about 205. Together they're about 215. So we only had like 150 roughly. So we chose the girls who were participating in sports and we demonstrated in front of the kids how to put it on with an underwear. They were all like that. I'm like, yeah, this is how we're doing this. So I also demonstrated how to wash them, soak it overnight, wash it in. The other one, and they were so amazed with the thought of bringing in second beans. They're like, well, these people are so much good because we even thought of the problem in case they were, of course, they would be. These girls are, I think here, you'll see the slide they show up, their size, they're not as big because they walk a lot. If they have 2 meals, that's good enough. So they are quite slender. Then the second school I went to, I was not able to go with the chief because the chief was to go to other meetings, or maybe it was just an excuse because I was just meeting the mayor. So on the second one, it was just so painful that I also tried to empower them to say, you know what, girls, you can do it. I was in that situation, or even worse, but look at me now. You just have to hold on, you just have to treat your body as the God's temple. Don't let anyone abuse you. That's when I went wrong, because there is this girl who approached me after. Yeah, I wouldn't say it's wrong because she has able to speak to me. She told me that you spoke about abuse. I have spoken to my teachers. My brother abuses me every weekend. And like my sister, he's been beating me. I have scars. He beats me from the where I come from, and I've shown my teacher that. They have tried to interfere with it, but it appears nothing is helping. Both the parents are out of the country trying to support their family. They're in South Africa right now. They work with names and that and going to try to help them out because of our situation in Zimbabwe. I was so down all day. I'm like, so when what happens? It's all nothing. I know this Friday he's coming and he's going to release him. Simply, a brother, not just a brother, nothing, a brother. So I felt like I did not help. The child was so helpless and hopeless. And he's from the teacher's perspective, he said, if I try to teach more, I don't even know where to put them, that kid. They live in our school settings are like they will build a school like this, and they will build teachers' houses around. And you are a stranger in that village. The only people you know is the students. So she has tried her best, and she felt like she had no more resources to help. I was like, oh, what do I do? You know, I felt. I'm buying tickets, powerhouse right now, in trying to, at least if I could afford maybe to go to the school, get all those abused kids, like, you get so overwhelmed, like, you, I just prepared, that's all. I shouldn't cry, because then the boys felt I was neglecting them when I was going to my car. The boy came, why do you always come here and you see the girls? Don't you mean that? I'm like, no, tomorrow I have no plans. Tomorrow I'm not going to come to see the boys. So I went, soccer is considered a male sport. So I went to see them play. They were so happy. I think I have some pictures as well. They were so happy that I was there. I had no plans for them, but they were just doing, they're doing good. They don't even have shoes to, I mean, not even just shoes, uniforms. They, what they do, you know how you are left and on the other side, the uniform is, the other party takes the shirts off, and that's it, they're playing, happy. And I'm like, wow. You know, so I did take pictures, and I promised that I was going to look for maybe old uniforms, doesn't matter the colors, and at least they will save their school uniforms, because every child puts on a school uniform just to have a child in the same level. So I also made that empty promise that I was going to look for soccer uniforms. So if anybody knows a school that is throwing out soccer uniforms, they can grow out at me. Good. So I talk a lot, he knows, so so I will end up to here, but the plan is to go back in December. And I was talking to one of the members here that my wish is to not to continue making this sanitary pad, is to get the patterns and get the fabric, and get machines made within sharing between those two schools, and maybe I'll spend 1 week teaching how to make a sanitary pad. I think that would be a solution to this problem that we have in my place. May God bless you. I love you all.
So as plates are passed around, imagine that you can't imagine where the money goes that you put in those plates. And imagine that there's so much more that goes in those plates besides the money. Part of what made this story possible was that what in the plates was sewing. Maybe that's what you are given to share. Time, passion, prayers. We give of all of our gifts for the sake of one another, our siblings. Dearly beloved, siblings in Christ, whatever happens, God will turn into grace. Listen to the stories of those whom you're tempted to walk past. You'll hear the voice of God. Go in peace. Serve God with joy.